Good afternoon to all of you, and I'd take this opportunity to thank Mr. Mitz and as well as Sarin Sara and other faculties in Muthoot for inviting the people for this program. And myself and Evan will be jointly taking this topic, which is entitled as Identification of Crash Black Spots and Priority Systems in Geographic Information System. And the topics which we basically will be covering will be a general scenario, overall scenario of the road crashes that is happening and the trend which is being followed. And then there will be something details about the road safety engineering aspects. And then something about the black spots, how it is defined, how it is prioritized, and how it can be managed. So, first of all, as I said, the crash scenario. We are now in that state of COVID pandemic spread and all those things. And we know that already more than 3 lakh people have died due to this COVID issues. But the fact that you can consider is that on a global scenario, on an average 1.35 million people, 13.5 million people are dying on roads due to road crashes. And most important thing to be noticed is that more than half of all these deaths are among the vulnerable road users, that is people that are more vulnerable, which basically belong to the pedestrians, so walking people, cyclists and motorcyclists. And an alarming thing is that often these, the low and middle income countries have 60% of the world's vehicle, but are having that 93% of the world's fatalities. So that is a thing to be taken care of. And a major issue is that road crashes are the leading cause of death for the young people aged between 5 to 29 years. So that blooming people are being killed due to this road crashes that has happened. And coming to the Indian scenario, this is the published data as per more than all those things. In the year 2018, we only have 2019 data, but it's not published. But for the year 2018, we had 4.67 lakh road crashes, that is reported road crashes, almost 5 lakh crashes, in which 1.52 lakh people died. That is, out of every 3 crashes, one fatality is being happening. And you see this 4.67 lakh crashes has resulted in having 4.7 lakh persons involved in these things. And to be on some sort of diminishing level, we can see that this is corresponding to 53 crashes per hour. So, barring down the long-term issues, we can see that once this topic is being covered, there could have been around 53 crashes. But fortunately and unfortunately, today it may not be there due to that low vehicle crash or low vehicle volume that is being planned. And every hour, there are 70 fatalities being happened due to road crashes. And for the 2016 to 17 data, that is at around the 12 year data, we can see that 1.6 million people died. People have died in India during these 12 years, and this is more than the population of Bharat. You just see that more than the one country's population. So that is the alarming situation. As to be summarized, India has got 1% of the world's vehicle population, and it's contributing to 11% of global road deaths. And to be as a continuation of the previous slide, 1.52 lakh deaths in 4.67 lakh crashes. And as I already said, 3 out of 10 crashes are fatal. And again, this can be summarized as 400 deaths per day, which is equivalent to a jumbo jet crash. Can you imagine that every day what jumbo is just happening and crashing? What would have been our response to that thing? So the things have been happening. So, but people are not taking that road crashes are so important as just crashing up a jumbo jet. But the fact is that road crashes accounted to 400 deaths per day, which is equal to one jumbo jet crash. And as I said, we said 17 deaths per hour, which is again corresponding to one death for every 4 minutes. So what is the big challenge? India is having that very high vehicle ownership and urbanization rates are being increasing. So our challenge is providing a safe and speedy mobility to people. That is a challenge to be addressed as far as people are concerned. Now, as I said, the trend, crash trend in India, just see, it is more or less the same, even from the year of 2005 to 2018. You see that the blue line is the total crashes and the yellow line, sorry, the red line is the total fatal crashes. So it is having the same trend throughout the period under consideration. Whereas that in 2005, it was around 4.5 nitrite crashes. Again, it is remaining the same, though it had a peak in around 2010 and 2015 like that. But the number of crash, fatal crashes is on an increasing trend. In 2005, it was around 90,000, and by 2018, it has come down to around 1.3. That is that we are not able to inspect our various efforts by the government and even that global decade of action or safety action. Also, all those things were taken care of, but we are not able to bring down that crashes and also as the fatalities could happen. The same is the case with the victims also, that you can see that the trend is the same irrespective of the year being concerned. So what is wrong? That is what we have to address. Again, this is another replication of that trend that I found. That is from 2017 to 2018. Around 15 years we are considering. You just see that here also from 2010, from where we had a rapid economic growth, the trend has remained almost the same. Now coming to our state level, crash scenario in Kerala. Here we are having another 2018 data also to be on a comparison. You can see that 2018 to 19, again, the number of crashes increased from 40,181 in 2018. It jumped to 41,153 in 2019. Around 1,000 crashes, number of crashes were increased. Same was the case with fatalities. From 4,303, now it is 4,408. 1,000 crashes increased and 1,000 fatalities increased. And overall, had a variation of 2.5% in 1.5%. Now, to be comparing on a national level, you can see that Kerala is the fifth position with 8.6% of the total crashes reported in the country. And it is corresponding to 111 road crashes per lakh population. For every lakh population we are considering, there are around 111 road crashes happening. And again, another alarming fact is that it is three times the national average. If the national average is three, then Kerala has got a crash frequency of 9. And coming to this under criteria, one test is 36% per lakh population were injured in road crashes. The injury rate is also high, and it is followed that it is the highest in the country, which is followed by Tamil Nadu. Now, this is the tabulation of showing the vehicles being involved in the road crashes as far as the 2018 data is concerned. You can see that the number of deaths was high for that vulnerable users, as I already said, which is the two areas of the pedestrians. Same was the case with the grievous injuries. Okay, and constituting comparison, these two is around 82 to 83% are bike riders and pedestrians. So we can, in a nutshell, we can see that these people or these are the target groups where we can have more focus so that the number of crashes or number of fatalities can be reduced. This is the trend of crashes in the state of Kerala also. Here also we can see that irrespective of the various measures being taken by the government and as well as various agencies, including ourselves, we are not able to have a deep a restriction on the number of crashes as well as the victims fatalities being happening. You see, in 2016 we had 47,000 victims. 2017 it was slightly brought down to 46,000, and again from 2018 it again increased to around 49,000. And then for the crashes also, from the 37,000 in 2016, which were almost remained the constant in 2017, with the 36,583. In 2018 we had around 3,500 crashes more being reported in Kerala. And coming to again another microscopic level, on that is on a district level analysis, we can see that Ernakulam is having that maximum number of crashes reported, and for the 3-year average, and again with the, followed by Thiruvananthapuram and all those things. Of course, we can see that these two are sort of the urban centers, and people are maybe again issues are is that are people driving at a crash risk in these urban cities. But anyway, this is a trend that is being followed. Now, this is the table tabulates the district wise number of victims and for the year 2016 to 18. Again, see that for the 3-year total, Ernakulam is the highest with 20,000, followed by Trivandrum around almost 20,000, and like that. Of course, Kasaragoda and Idukki, all those things are having the very least number of crashes, crash victims being reported. Now, this is an index which shows that the crash rate per kilometer or number of crashes per vehicle like that. Because we cannot compare that absolute numbers, number of crashes from year to year. This table shows the crashes per kilometer. We are taking it to some kind of unit level analysis. From 2016 to 18, that it is being shown, you can see that number of fatal crashes, that index is remaining almost a constant for the 20 crashes, it is 0.02. Whereas for the grievous injuries, it is again 0.13. And the total crashes, you see, that also is 0.18, 0.17, 0.18. So again, we can see that for these 3 years also, the index value is also remaining the same. Now, what can we do as an engineer or a road safety expert or road safety professional like that? Here comes the role of road safety engineer. What is that? A road environment. That is, an environment means which is something in total. It should meet the basic objectives. What are the objectives? We need to move. That is the mobility. And we need to move efficiently. We need to move for, reach a place at that effective way. And also we should have enough amenities for getting into our mobility. So we can see that a road environment must meet the basic objectives of mobility, efficiency, safety, and amenity. And also this involves what is that? Managing and reducing the risk of fatalities or injuries to road users. Of course, we are not in a position to reduce the total number of crashes, but at least we should have some kind of system to manage and reduce the risk of fatalities or injuries. Even if a crash happens, then the number of fatalities or number of injuries should be very minimal. And road safety engineering, RSE, in short, applies these engineering principles to improve the safety of the road environment and thereby reduce the total cost of road crashes to the community. You see that every crash has got its own total cost. If something happens to me, my family will be affected, my organization will be affected, the people dependent, all those things are there. So we have, there is some kind of monetary value for this, for each and every one of our lives. So ultimately this RSE is attempting to reduce total cost of crashes. And it is basically crash prevention and behavior modification, how I am behaving as a road user. And finally, injury control as well. Now, speed and crashes. You see this last month also, we had no vehicles on the road, but the number of crashes were still there. Of course, comparing to that previous year, total number of crashes have very much come down, but the number of fatalities or the even the rate of fatalities was still the same, almost matching with the index of the previous year. So what was wrong? Maybe people might have been speeding because there was no traffic. So ultimately we can say that basically most of the crashes have happened due to overspeed or like this. So we all know, we are all engineers, and we know that there is some kind of speed calculation being involved, like which is being used for determining that speed distance, sorry, braking distance, stopping distance, like that. So basically speed increases the chance that a crash can happen. And what is that? High speed means late reaction. We all know that we are moving very fast means we are getting very that least time to have a reaction approach. There is the more distance covered to make decisions and take our action to avoid collision. You know that if suppose you are moving at 100 km per hour, which is equivalent to around 26 meters per second, by the time you might have seen that a vehicle needs to be stopped and you apply the brakes and all those things. Even with a reaction time of 2 seconds, you might have traveled almost 15 minutes. And that by that time, you might have happened, collided with an object or a pedestrian. What is that? The faster you are going, the longer it takes for the vehicle to stop. And when you do brake, and even if you do brake, chances of avoiding a collision become smaller because you are moving at a very high speed and you will not be in a position to control your vehicle to stop before it is being hit onto the pedestrian or to the an object or to another vehicle. So basically speed is the one which is to be controlled as a total. Now, what is the importance of road safety engineering? You see that this diagram is depicting a road section, which has got a very long straight section wherein a vehicle might be moving at 100 kilometers per hour. And suddenly you see that there is a curve over there on which there is a deep valley on one hand side. So what is to be done here? You are negotiating a curve and you are moving at 100 kilometers per hour. What is that minimum thing you will be doing? You will be applying the brakes. And why? Because you need to contain your speed. And what is the speed? That speed will be dependent upon the geometrics of the curve to be negotiated. That means the curve radius and all those things. So here we can see that applying the basic equation of E plus V is equal to V square by 127R, the permissible speed through which at which this curve can be negotiated is coming to 33 kilometers per hour. And what is that? Is it that the speed containment only can benefit this crash reduction? You see, as I already said, there is a deep valley over there. So what is that? We have to have some kind of constraint measures, like maybe crash barriers and all those things, so that even if the vehicle driver has not reduced his speed, he may hit the crash barrier and will contain this movement to this curve. And anyway, again, is it just enough? You see that arrow marks over there, where that line markings are given, the arrow directions are given, and just near to the curve area, we have that double line is also being started. That is, in advance, the driver is being informed that there is some kind of control he needs to exercise, because he is going to negotiate a curve wherein he needs to take care. He may be posed to a risk. So here, all these are some of the things which comes under the round 50 engineering measures. That is, he needs to contain his speed, and in addition to that, we as an engineer has to give enough safety measures so that the vehicle is not being sent into the deep valley, and is the driver is getting injured. Now, as I said, travel speed, which is basically based upon which we do all kinds of design and all those things, and which is dependent, on which all these factors are being dependent. First of all is functional classification. We all know that the roads are being classified into national highways, state highways, village roads, epidemic roads, and on an urban scenario, it may be classified as arterials, subarterials, factor streets, and even on the highest end on express lanes and all those things. So this classification is basically based upon that speed through which these roads can permit. So there, that importance of speed is there. Then the land use. You cannot have a 100 kilometers per hour speed on an urban section where both sides we have got residential activity, or where if there is a school, we cannot have that 100 kilometer per hour, or even 850 kilometer per hour. So the land use is again contributing to that speed through which speed at which the vehicle can fly. Then the stopping distance. I said that curve is there, so you need to, you maybe need to have apply your brakes and all those things. So but stopping distance is there. Then the sight distance, again, we know that 0.27 AD, which is the basic equation. Then the alignment, the geometry, and all those things. The lane width which we need to keep, and ultimately the super elevation, that is the banking of curves which we need. So the travel speed and the other factors are mutually dependent on each other. You can see that again, speed has got its own contribution to reduction in crashes. Now, why? Again, I'm telling about the crash speed and crashes. Crashes at higher speeds cause more severe injuries. Why? Because higher the speed, more is the kinetic energy. We all know that the kinetic energy in this equation is the half m into v square, velocity square is there. The more the speed, the energy imparted will be, the energy being dissipated will be square of the velocity. And the higher the speed, more is the kinetic energy. And suppose I'm moving at, say, 100 km per hour, and my vehicle is colliding into another vehicle or even a stationary object. What is that? That the energy is being transmitted from my vehicle to the other vehicle. That is, more energy is released when colliding into another vehicle or stationary object, because the more the speed, the more is the energy. And now, what is that? Part of the energy, I'm hitting a vehicle or an object or a stationary object, and part of the energy will be absorbed by the objects. But you see that there is a limit to which energy, a body can absorb energy. So the whatever energy I am just transmitting to the other vehicle or the object, only will be, a part will be absorbed. And the remaining part will be absorbed by the human body, causing injuries. And the main thing is to be noted is our human body is vulnerable. We all know that our body is just composed of muscles and bones and all those things, which are not so rigid in all those things. So it is very much vulnerable, and there is very little bit of energy that it can handle to be seriously injured. So what is that ultimately? The more energy, the greater the damage. So to be in a nutshell, to summarize, I'm moving at a high speed, I will be imparting a very high energy to the other object, and very limited energy will be absorbed by the body, and again, will, the result will be maybe grievous or fatal. No, as I said, suppose the hit body in which I was hit was again moving, then the effect might not be so much. But if it is a very stationary object like a pedestrian or cyclist and persons in lighter vehicles, suppose I'm moving in a tank or lorry, whatever, and another one is a just maybe a two wheeler or something like that. We know that energy absorption will be very less, and there will be more severe injuries if it is hit by a speeding vehicle. And in a collision, the energy absorbed or released will be absorbed more by the lighter side because of the difference in mass. The lesser the mass, the more will be the energy which needs to be absorbed. And pedestrians and cyclists are totally unprotected. You all know they don't have any views or anything like that. They are totally unexposed. So they will be more vulnerable. They will have to catch more energy, and the fatality rate will be very high. And this is why, as I said in the initial slide, 82% of the crashes are prone to happening to vulnerable road users and pedestrians and two-wheelers, where we can see that both these categories are on an unprotected domain. They don't have any gear or anything, and they are not within a vehicle. They are not within a vehicle. Even a two-wheeler is there, he is not in a vehicle, he is just unexposed. But what is the impact of speed? Just this is some of the early studies. Literature has shown that if a vehicle which is moving at a speed of 30 km per hour, then the chances of a person surviving the collision is 90%. Only 10% is the chance that will result in a fatality. And what is that? If the vehicle speed has increased to 50 km per hour, then the chances of fatalities is increasing by 30%, from 10% to 40%. Now again, if the vehicle speed is increased to 65 km per hour, the chances of survival is 20% and the chance of fatality is 80%. That is, the more the speed, the more is the chance of a fatal. To be in a nutshell, 1 km per hour increment, a speed increment of even 1 km per hour can increase the fatalities by around 4 to 5%. And just a 5 km per hour reduction in speed, if you are reducing your speed of the vehicle by at least 5 km per hour, you can reduce the chances of fatalities by up to 30%. So this is something to be taken in mind. Now, what is the role of transportation professionals? What is that? As I already said, we need to consider safety in the planning and design of new roads. Is it just enough? We have to consider safety in the planning as well as the design of new roads. Is it not enough? It is that we have to improve the safety of the existing roads also, because already some road is there and we have to improve the safety. Why or how? We have to identify the hazardous locations, that is the locations where crashes are more there, crashes are on an increased scale, and you have to deploy safety countermeasures so that finally we are having very least number of crashes on our roads. Now, engineering aspects of safe road infrastructure design. Safe road infrastructure design. See, we need to consider safety in the planning stage, design stage, construction stage, and maintenance and operation stage. Even from the very start of planning a road, we need to have that safety concern in our mind. How is that? In the planning stage, some of the examples is that land use control policies and bypasses, something like that. Suppose we are planning a expressway, or planning a national highway, planning a bypass like that. What is that? We need to have, we all know that expressways are supposed to have high velocity vehicles, high speed vehicles to be passed on. So that we will not be, we need to have some kind of zoning policy, some kind of policy, land use policy, so that pedestrian activities are very minimal in that area. So that kind of land use policies are there. And suppose we are planning a bypass, what is that? And you are not supposed to plan a bypass through a heavy built area. Or in another way, bypasses are meant for bypassing the heavily built area. Another thing is zoning. We need to have separate land use zoning so that the safety aspect is concerned. Now coming to design stage, here where that safety concern is the most important thing. We need to have design speed, that is the speed at which that design is to be done. Then the design is there for the horizontal and vertical geometry. Then cross-sectional elements. What are the cross-sectional elements? Right of way, starting from the right of way to that, and finally merging at the median, carry framework, right of way, solder method, all those things. Then design of upgrade and grade separated junctions. You know that grade separated junctions are also there. Upgrade means there are two, three intersections and all around the same level, and we need, can have grade separation. And then provision of service roads. What is a service road? Service roads are basically provided on either sides of national highways or expressways, wherein the service roads are meant for service. That is, the local land use people are to local people living have need to have a local access. So we need to have provide service roads. That aspect is to be considered in the design stage. And designing effective road furniture, including the guardrails, truck signages, markings, and all those things. Now coming to construction stage, here also that barricading things are to be considered, traffic diversions are to be provided, signage issues, environmental controls for reducing noise, dust, etc. And finally, maintenance and operation stage. We can have automated traffic management systems like mobile communication systems, variable messaging signs to show that the speed limit is 65 or the speed limit is 80 or there is a pedestrian movement like that. Then weigh in motion system to weigh the vehicles, load and all those things. And there can be a centralized control system to take account of all those things. Now, coming to the tools in OCT engineering, basically we can take areas and data, then from there to the procedures and processes, and finally the analytical techniques. Data is composed of basically the traffic composition and the audio. That is how many two wheelers are there, what the number of cars are there, and even the, and also the number of even these type of vehicles. We all know that India has got very heterogeneous mix of vehicles, and that is where this traffic composition takes into account. Then the road network characteristics and asset condition. What is the road network that is there? Is it a national highway or all those things? And what is that asset levels like the pavement width and all those things? Then the travel speeds, the speeds through which the vehicles are permitting, the traffic facilities over there, the dot geometric data, the curve radius, the super elevation radius, so super elevation and all those things. The demography data, something related to the urban, the local land use and all those things. Then finally, the crash data, how many crashes are happening, what kind of crashes are happening, who are the victims like that, and the cost being. Now, coming to the procedures and processes, we need to have a crash and road database management. Finally, we need a database and a management of those. For safety inspections are to be taken care of, are to be done to have an inspection of the very vulnerable also the pedestrian, so the crash prone locations. Then the crash investigations are to be there. If some crash is happening, a team has to go there and to investigate what went wrong, why the crash happened like that. Then black spot management and remedial measures, which is will be taken in this course itself. Then the road safety audits of the designs and existing roads and network safety management. We know that we cannot take one road as a single entity. It is a combination, it's a part of the network. So the network level safety management is also very critical. And coming to the analytical techniques, we need to have crash rate analysis, risk assessment, economic analysis from the cloud post and all those things. Then countermeasure evaluation. When you are suggesting some kind of countermeasures, how we need to evaluate how much is that the effect of these countermeasures on that safety reduction. Then prediction modeling, crash prediction modeling. Suppose I'm in making in the one of the sites I have shown, I am providing some kind of barricading like thing. What is the effect of the barricade on the crash prediction? Or suppose I am providing some kind of marking or even some kind of widening. So what is that effect of that my intervention on that reduction and so on? So some kind of that things also is to be there. And finally, we need to have a target setting. That is, suppose 10 crashes are happening and 5 fatalities are there, I need to have a target that this much kind of reduction is happening in our print. Now, from the previous slide, I said about the data and all those things. What is the significance of crash data? The existence of a reliable crash data is a prerequisite to improve road safety. Because first of all, we need to know what is happening and why that is happening. So that is why we need to have a crash database. And this will be used to identify the road users at risk and finally the crash black spots. Who are the victims? Why it is happening like that? And the crash black spots on a particular road stretch or a section, how many black, what is the vulnerable prone locations and finally the black spots. And again, this data is very much required for identifying the factors that are contributing to the crashes. and for, based upon which only we can have that development of carbon bushes. As I said, suppose a curve is there and there is no or a deep valley, there is a deep valley on either side, and we see that a lot of rushes are happening. We need to we know that why that is happening and what are the countermeasures that is going to be implemented over there. So that is the significance of crash data. Now, so what are some of the elements of this crash data is assessing? As I said, who are involved? Is it the vehicle driver it's alone? Is it a passenger alone? Is it somebody on the footpath? Are any animals involved? Are there any stationary objects which are involved? So that kind of who are involved thing is there. Then when this happened, it's a temporal distribution. Was it on a daytime? Was it on a night time? Was it on peak hour? Or was it on an off time like that? Then where it happened, spatial distribution can be, this spatial distribution can be either latitudinal or longitudinal. Is it on a edge of the road, on the center line, on the median, or is it on a maybe some straight section is there? Is it at the very start, or at the end, or at the beginning, or at the center? Then what are the causes and types of crashes? Is it a head-on collision? Is it a pedestrian hitting a vehicle hitting a pedestrian? Is it a pedestrian hitting a vehicle hitting a stationary object? And was it an overtake a crash that happened due to overtaking? Was it something that is hitting on a tree or something like that? So what are the causes and the types of crashes that were there? And finally, how severe are the crashes? A crash has happened. How much? What is the severity? We know that severity can be fatalities, grievous injuries, minor injuries, or property damage only. So how many persons killed in that crash? How many persons got grievous injuries? How many you had minor injuries? Or was it just a video, like a property damage? So these are some of the elements which this crash data is trying to capture. Now, this crash data can be analyzed on a macroscopic level and on a microscopic level. In the initial slides, I showed that the analysis on a global level, then they came down to national level, then to state level, and then to district level. All these things are macroscopic area, macroscopic data. That is, I'm seeing on a whole. On a whole, I'm telling how many crashes were there in Kerala, how many crashes are there in Trivandrum, or how many crashes are there in that Ernakulam or Konnachery area like that. Then this is basically a descriptive analysis will be there. We can see that study our Trivandrum area is Ernakulam. 80% were pedestrians, 20% of tourists like that. Descriptive analysis only can be performed. And now, to be on an inner depth, this, we can have that microscopic analysis that your engineering college junction is there, vertically junction is there. So, how we can see how many crashes happen in that particular intersection. Or how many crashes happen in that particular road, or maybe even that particular change. That is what is called a microscopic level analysis. Here, we will be identifying problems and treatments to enhance safety at the intersection or the roadway. Here it will be more specific, more site-specific interventions can be made. You can see that a particular location is there, suppose your injection, some intersection is there and pedestrian crashes are more. Then we can see that there the pedestrian crashes are more and we need to specifically address the pedestrian issues, maybe some kind of footpath level issues or some kind of grade separated pedestrian facilities like that. That is what is being the difference between this microscopic analysis and the microscopic analysis. Now, road safety engineering is basically for crash reduction and as well as crash prevention. As I said, there can be some kind of, there's a road where crashes are more there. So we need to have some kind of reactive approach. That is, we need to have some approach so that the crashes are coming down. And here, the things which will be dealt with will be something like a black spot management. The black definition of black spot priorities and all those things in this area we'll be talking about. I'm not touching on the 6 months. Black spot management can be there. Then the road safety inspection. A team of experts can inspect the site of the space and can see what is wrong and what can be done. Then the crash investigation. A crash has happened. Then their team can go there and can see what went wrong, why it happened, when it happened. Was it due to some kind of a road engineering issue? Was it due to behavioral issue? Or was there any other reason like that? Then we can have the road safety audit of the existing roads. Can have an audit of the safety of these existing roads and again the network safety management. Now again, we see that there is a road and we can have some kind of approach that some kind of proactive approach so that no crash will happen there. Here, things basically will be the safety or the various dangers, which are on an IRC course are also there, where the we can have road safety audit at the feasibility stage itself. Suppose you are planning a road, that is, you are doing the, even the feasibility of that road, and there again you can see what are the chances of a crash to that can happen in that road. Then you can have the road safety audit at the design stage, and even during the pre-opening stage, you are not opening the road to the traffic. Before that, you can have that road safety audit, and you can have your proactive approach so that crash prevention will happen. And then you can have that road safety impact assessment also as part of this priority approach. So here I'm just stopping, and from here, Mr. Evinson will be taking it off. Sorry?
Hello. I'm out. Okay. Okay. Hello. Good afternoon, all. Thank you, Sanjay sir. Thank you, Sarin and Muthoot, for giving this opportunity. Now I am going to tell details about the black spot management, which comes under the road safety engineering. It's a reactive approach within the discipline of road safety. The black spot management involves scientific analysis of crash data, identifying the nature and cause of crashes at the black spots. After identification and identifying the cause, we need to design appropriate engineering measures to reduce the number of crashes to ready and to reduce the number of risk of that particular road stretch or that location. And after that, the treatment of black spot through implementation by the concerned road owning agencies. And after that, we need to evaluate the countermeasures implemented, whether it was successful or not. I'm going to going in detail regarding the all these aspects. This is a chart which is showing the black spot management, identification of crash prone location, diagnosing the problem, selection of countermeasures, detailed design, implementing the treatment, and monitoring and evaluation. Coming to the identification of crash prone location. Identification of crash prone location involves crash data collection and verification. We need to collect data from either from the police station or from the DCRB or SCRB, because police are the primary source of crash data, and the they are the first one to visit the crash location. And from that, we need to build a crash database, which comprises of crash locations, road network, traffic, and other parameters. And after that, there should be an appropriate criteria for defining high crash locations or crash prone locations. There are a number of criteria available in outside India. It may be some small points or short stretches of 50 meter or 100 meter are taken. India, we have another definition. Then the identification of crash prone locations and also the prioritization of crash prone location. We need to identify the crash prone location, and after that, we need to prioritize them. Which crash prone location should be treated first? Which should have the second priority, like that. And the crash black spot analysis involve spatial analysis of crash data. It contains spatial road network, geocoding the crash data, and development of crash database. These all aspects can be done in GIS. A particular point can have a multiple crashes at a point, and we need to identify those stretches or locations which have more number of crashes or more number of points. And after that, geospatial analysis will be performed in GIS to find the crash accumulation. And after finding the crash accumulation, and based on the criteria which we are adopting, we can identify the black spots. This is the overall road network for, say, Ernakulam district. This is a GIS map which was prepared. And these are the geocoded crash spots. We can see the red and as well as yellow colors. The red are the fatal crash spots, the location where fatal crashes occurred during the last three calendar years. And the yellow spots are the location where previous injury crashes were occurred during the last three calendar years. This I am citing the example of Ernakulam district. Then so in literatures we can see hazardous road location, crash prone location, black spot, high crash locations, etc. Different countries use their different terminologies. But it's a definition. High crash location can be an individual site, say it can be an intersection or a curve or a series of curves like that, or a length of road which could be in an urban stretch or in a rural stretch, or it can be area of road network, say some CBD area or some suburb area, residential area like that, or location of road network which have common hazardous characteristics. Some locations have common characteristics or crash type, like pedestrian crashes or head-on crashes. In urban areas, pedestrian crashes are seen to be high, so that can be also considered as high crash locations for pedestrians. In GIS, we will accumulate or agglomerate these crashes which have similar crash characteristics. In this image, we have agglomerated pedestrian characteristics. We can see that in one area, the crash density is more compared to the other. So it can be a stretch, a stretch of road where the pedestrian crashes are more. We call it as a linear zone, or a circular zone, or an area zone where the pedestrian crashes are high. I'm citing pedestrian crashes, but there are many other crashes like head-on crashes, rear-end crashes, run-off road crashes, etc. And identifying high crash location, the crashes tend to cluster together at location termed as high crash location. For identifying the high crash location or crash blast, so accurate location data is very essential. The annual crash numbers, if you take a yearly crash data, it may fluctuate at any site. So we use a minimum of 3-year data to identify the black spot location or high crash locations. It's better to analyze the junctions and links separately, but include 50 meters of each junction as part of the junction. Why we are doing clustering? Because if we do clustering, we can found that a particular crashes are is predominant in a particular location or stretches. So we need to identify the cause, identify what type of crash it is happening in that location or a stretch, and we need to identify the common causes and also counter them by applying appropriate countermeasures. Once the individual sites are treated, then the crash clusters will continue to diminish. In India, we follow the ministry's MORTH protocol for black spot identification of black spot. It is a stretch of defined on national highways. It's a stretch of road of 500 meter length where 5 crashes involving fatalities or grievous injury or 10 fatalities that took place during the last 3 calendar years. This is a pictorial representation and the 500 meter road stretch in which the 5 road crashes involving fatalities or grievous injuries during the last 3 calendar years or 10 fatalities during the last 3 calendar years. And after obtaining the black spot, we can prioritize them by using appropriate index. There are many indices available, some crash severity index, accident severity index, weighted severity index in literatures. It gives some severity factors to each type of crashes. Say for fatal crash, it gives A1. For my grievous injury, it gives A2. For minor injury crashes, it gives A3. And non-injury crashes, A4. Usually, my minor injury crash and non-injury crash are not considered for scientific analysis purpose because they are grossly underreported in Indian conditions. So we have conducted a study for the identification of black spots in Kerala state, of which we identified nearly 340 priority black spots. There was nearly 4,000 high-risk locations we identified, of which we prioritized 340 priority black spots based on the threshold value, and we sorted them as high risk and moderate risk location. The stretches or locations above 110 of the threshold value we considered as high risk location, and we found that in Kerala there are 232 locations, and above, I mean between 93 and 110, there was one 108 location which we classified as moderate risk location. These are the district wise classification of high black spot location. We can see that Thiruvananthapuram, Kollam, Alappuzha and Ernakulam have most number of black spots compared to other locations. This is a classification according to the road type. We have national highways, state highways and other roads. Almost nearly 221 black spots fall on the national highway stretch. Of course, then the traffic is more on the national highway, and risk is also very high. And the state highways and have 80 numbers, and other roads have 39 numbers. This is a priority crash black spots in northern Kerala, central Kerala, and southern Kerala. So we have identified the black spot. Then next step is problem identification. For that, we need detailed crash data. We need FAR level detailed crash data to identify the type of collision, identify the possible causes behind the accidents. After taking that, we will conduct a field surveys to locate the GPS location of the crash spots. We need to conduct traffic volume, pedestrian volume count surveys, spot speed surveys to understand the operating speed. Road inventories and surveys will be conducted to understand the width of the road infrastructure provided at the location. And after that, we will further conduct the geospatial analysis to find out whether where these crashes are concentrating within this 500 meter stretch. And a joint inspection will be conducted with the help of researchers, by academicians, by police, by motor vehicle department, and health department, etc. All stakeholders will conduct joint road safety inspection, and they will chalk out their own plan to mitigate the accidents. We need to also discuss with the public get more ground level information on the road safety issue prevailing on the ground. Then we need from these we will get many solutions, but we need to identify the treatable problems from the data from subsequent discussions, and identify those issues, and we prepare a report based on the data collection. This is a collision sample collision diagram. This collision diagram, this type of collision diagram was used in foreign countries 20 or 30 years before. We can see it's a curve. We can see that there are number of run off road on the outside portion of the curve, which is the predominant crash type in this curve. Over the years, the technology has improved. Now we are using the GIS technology for visualizing the crash hotspot locations, and we can see that the some stretches as a particular type of crash. Say this is a heat map of Ernakulam district. We can see that in Angamali area, Angamali Karukutty area, as well as in the city CBD area, the heat map is high for rear end collision. If we consider other type of collision, pedestrian type of collision, it will shift to other location. Say runoff road, we can see the runoff road, the heat map is in the other location. So based on the crash types, we can identify the crash types, and based on the crash types, the heat maps can be generated, and subsequent treatment can be provided at these locations. The high crash locations are short stretches where crashes take place repeatedly and or gets created on the road due to reasons like omissions or commissions in the development project, changes in the roadside environment, changes in the development scenario of the region, unplanned and development or unauthorized construction, etc. In the rectification of crash black spots is a continuous process. Even if we rectify one black spot, the other location and the numbers may increase. We need to rectify that location as well. These are the predominant crash types which we find in our country and state, and these are the potential countermeasures which we can identify. These countermeasures need to be applied as per the site conditions. head-on collisions, rear-end collision, hit from side, then side swipe is there, hitting stationary vehicle or parked vehicle, and then hit pedestrian, then crashes involving cyclists, runoff road, and intersection crashes. So if we identify stretch where the pedestrian accidents are more, say we identified that more than 70% of people involved in crashes are pedestrians, and there is no pedestrian facility. Also, there are 80% of crashes are of daytime crashes, and also traffic ply at high speed. So what is the matching solution for that? So if there is no pedestrian facility and crashes are more on the pedestrian, we need to improve the pedestrian facilities, and traffic operating at high speed can be reduced by applying appropriate traffic calming measures, which involve providing rumble strip or thermoplast bar markings or raised pedestrian crossings, etc. And how we select the countermeasures? The prevailing road and traffic environment will be studied. Possible causes of crashes and safety concerns will be identified. Detailed inspection, preparation of base map with a road boundary will be carried out. Topographic surveys will be conducted. Then the matching solution or treatments, I explained in the previous slide, will be worked out. And competing requirement and priorities also will be worked out. And also in all crash prone location, we need to identify the vulnerable road users requirement. Who are our vulnerable road users? They are two-wheelers and pedestrians. Of course, are cyclists as well. These three are the vulnerable road users, and they together contribute to 80 to 85% of the crash victims in Kerala. Also, while selecting the countermeasures, it should give clarity to the road measures, and this kind of confusions should be avoided while providing the treatment or matching solutions. Then, what are the basic strategies for crash reduction? The basic strategies involve a single site or black spot programs, or route action plan, area wide action plan, or mass action plan. Single site treatment. That's a treatment of specific site or a short length of road. Say we have a 500 meter road stretch, we will identify the causes and we will conduct detailed surveys and we'll treat the black spot. Sometimes that issue may be within the 500 meter stretch or beyond 500 meters stretch. So we will generally consider 500 meter before and 500 meter after this crash plan location and crash location. So the total of 1.5 kilometer will be there. Then route action, MC road or NH road. So where there is a high crash rate. So we concentrate on that core road corridor where the number of crashes are high, and apply remedies accordingly. Then mass action plan. That is, some stretches have common crash characteristics, say pedestrian crashes or head-on crashes or rear-end crashes like that. So we will apply remedies and location with these common crash locations. Then area-wide schemes, say the throughout area, say CBD area, a ward level or a city level, we'll investigate crash throughout the entire area and apply area-wide remedies. Then coming to the rectification of black spot. Now for the rectification of black spot, first thing we need to consider is a road safety inspection or preliminary inspection. Then the detailed road safety audit. Detailed road safety audit is a systematic process which involves a procedure which need to be carried out based on one IRC code. That's one IRC code is there. The based on the road safety inspection, the concerned agencies or scientific persons will visit the location and will provide appropriate treatment for them. From these engineering studies, we will formulate short-term or immediate measures, the medium-term measures as well as long-term measures for reducing the crash risk. Detailed engineering principles involve conduct of roads, topographic surveys, detailed design of countermeasures, preparation of scheme drawings, technical specification, BOQ, bill of quantities, bid documents, etc. Short-term measures. The short-term measures involve the provision of providing road signs, speed restriction or speed calming measures, pavement markings, road studs, delineators, pedestrian railing, crash barriers, etc. Also, the enforcement on the enforcement side, traffic restriction can be carried out, say for certain type of vehicles, or by time, or by lane, one-way roads, reversible lines, bus lines, etc. These are the medium-term or interim measures which can be adopted at the crash-prone locations. The extra widening of curves, improving horizontal and vertical geometry. In Kerala, we have horizontal curves, vertical curves, also combination of horizontal and vertical curves, which increase the crash risk in the state. And also provision of pedestrian facilities like footpath, railing, pedestrian crossing, etc. And then street lighting, crash barriers, overall junction improvement, then the side distance improvement, signalization, removing obstructions which hamper the side distance. And long-term measures. Long-term measures are provision of a bypass, provision of service road, provision of gates, interchanges, pedestrian vehicular underpasses, foot over bridge, etc. This is a low-cost solution and a difference between high-cost solution. On the left side, say we can say an example as Kudran curves. The long-term solution is for creating a tunnel, but it takes nearly 5 to 10 years to complete the tunnel. For the meantime, we can opt for low-cost design solution. We can see the traffic calming measures provided. We can curve signs are provided, delineator signs are provided, crash barriers are provided on the valley side. So advanced signs markings are provided. So low cost solution can be adopted for a short time period, but for sustainable long term solution, high cost design solutions are available. Then while implementing the treatment, we need to collect the baseline data prior implementation. It is very essential that essential to collect that baseline data prior implementation, because we need to evaluate how effective is the countermeasure which we have suggested and applied. If it is there is some lacuna, we can rectify it in the further application. Then we need to rank the project, prioritize the project. Then treatments also can be ranked according to the budget. In construction supervision, inter-department, inter-agency coordination is very much essential. Then publicity and enforcement is required, and also documentation of adequate records and baseline data. Then after construction, we should do monitoring and evaluation part. We have observed that even after rectifying the crash black spots, the crash risk remains the same or even higher. So what's the problem behind it? So we need to have a baseline data, post implementation data. We need to sit and compare the data as do scientific analysis, statistical analysis, and identify the cause of recurrence of crashes at these locations. The monitoring and evaluation comprises of initial monitoring, which is the period of 6 to 1 year, and periodic monitoring we will do for three years after collecting data for 3 years. So the road safety evaluation studies can be conducted based on before and after studies for comparison using control sites. We will take similar sites and we will compare that with the location. We can do time trend and a comparison, or control experimentation can be done. This is a black spot improvement proposal in Karnataka, just finalized by MoRTH. This is the existing black spot location. The topographic drawing is shown. And we have given the remedial measures. We can see the road is widened. Yeah, they have provided footpath. They have provided adequate signs. Junction improvement is made. And main traffic calming measures are provided. This is a treated black spot location. Medians are also provided. This is a junction improvement which was performed in that intersection. We can see the crosswalks, and delineators, channelizer, footpath, etc. Advanced signs, markings. This is immediate cautioning at black spot. MoRTH has recommended to place this sign at the crash black spots in throughout the entire country. Because the rectification and investigation of black spot takes considerable time, so we need to alert the road users in advance regarding the high risk of the stretch. Is the indicative shorter measurement? There is a crash prone location road sign with a speed limit. Red LED solar blinkers and can be provided. Ladder type road markings, rumble strips along with transverse road studs with accompanied by road signs can be provided. Longitudinal road studs, adequate street lighting, box marking at the intersection, pedestrian walkway and crossway location wherever it is warranted, and the restriction end sign. Also, we need to go for ITS enforcement camera, which have artificial intelligence to identify violating all type of violation and generate automatic challenging system. Towards concluding, the death and the crowd death and injuries caused by the road crash are preventable. The combination of six E's will definitely reduce the road crashes, which involve engineering measures, enforcement measure, education, emergency response, which involve ambulance and all hospitals and all, then continuous evaluation. Based on these five parameters, we will get the and subsequent research, we will get many new ideas which we need to enact as law for keeping the road safe. So basically, these are the six E's of road safety. If all the agencies and all the departments working in the respective field come together and work in a concerted manner, we can definitely reduce the road crash in the state as well as in the country. Thank you all for this. Over to Seren. If anyone can, anyone have any question, you can ask. There is one question: if we need from where we get an accident data in Kerala, we can contact the SCRB for SCRB means Kerala State Crime Records Bureau for the crash data. And on district level, there is DCRBs, District Crime Records Bureau. We can contact them, and they will surely share the data. Police is very much interested in reducing the crashes in the state. Then please explain the sixth E in the last conclusion. It's basically enactment of laws. Over here, because we have enacted last Motor Vehicle Act amendment was 1988. After 30 years, we revised the Motor Vehicle Act. It's a long gap. Even the seatbelt and helmet usage are made mandatory in 1993 amendment. But still, we are recently only we are implementing or enforcing it strictly. So we should enact laws based on the research outcome at least for within a period of 5 years to take the challenges of new technologies. To now we can see people are using mobile phones. So we need to change laws based on the research outcome. We are engineering research outcomes and experiences.